السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Welcome to a live session of Ask an Imam. My name is Farhan Iqbal and this is a live program where you can ask any questions about Islam, about Ahmadiyyat, about other world religions, and answers are provided in light of resources found on the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim Community, www.alislam.org. That is alislam.org. That is the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim Community. You are watching this program on multiple platforms. That includes Twitter, Facebook, and YouTube. If you are on Twitter, you can use the live chat that is right next to the video to submit your questions. If you are on, if you're on YouTube, you can use the live chat. And if you are on Twitter, you can use the live stream itself to submit your questions. And if you are on Facebook, you can use the comment section to submit your questions. There's a great, debate that is going on in one Muslim country about expressing love for the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I thought that it is important to know about this topic, and it is important to understand this topic, that when it comes to love for the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what is the best way to show that love? We have, in this regard, it is important to remember that the Holy Quran tells us how we can express that love. It says that when other people are trying to insult the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, your response as Muslims should be that you send durood, you send blessings upon the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala ali Muhammadin kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka Hamidu Majid. Allahumma barik ala Muhammadin wa ala ali Muhammadin kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka Hamidu Majid. That is the first and foremost way for us to show our love for the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam by praying for him. That, oh Allah, bless Muhammad and his people sallallahu alaihi wasallam, just as you blessed Abraham and his people. And then we say, oh Allah, make them prosper as you prospered Abraham and his people. So this is the way to show true love for the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And there are resources on Al-Islam. There are books that you can utilize for this purpose. For instance, there is one book, True Love for the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this book discusses this issue at length. This is a book by Hazrat Mirza Masroor Ahmad, may Allah be his helper. And, after the international conspiracy against Islam, against the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, using vulgar language, obscene descriptions, distortions, propaganda, all these things in the name of free speech and Western civilized values, what is our response as Muslims? And Hazur delivered his Friday sermon on September 12th at Bath al Futuh Mosque in UK in response to all of this. And you can download the PDF and you can see that there are multiple options for you on the page to go through this book in multiple formats and learn what the Islamic response to this is. And this is the verse of the Holy Quran that I was talking about, where Allah says that Allah and his angels send blessings on the Prophet. O ye who believe, you also invoke blessings on him and salute him with a salutation of peace. Right? And this is what our true response is. And our other response is to speak about the beauties of the character of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and enable people to learn about the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and to know more about the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that should be our real goal. Instead of reacting in any other way, there are some Muslims who get very excited about this and very angry, which it is understandable. But that anger should not be aimed at other Muslims or at creating a situation of lawlessness or anything like that. The feelings that Muslims have on these occasions should be funneled towards talking about the beauties of the character of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and talking about these beauties with non-Muslims. You know, those people who have learnt about the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they have always praised him. There have even been examples of people who decided that they are going to write something against the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or against Islam. They became converts to the religion of Islam when they decided that they are going to write against Islam or write against the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When they read his life, when they read his biography, they were so impressed. So our responsibility is to respond to all of these things by showing the world the truly beautiful, magnificent character and personality of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. And politicizing the issues and these kinds of things, that's not what we should be doing. Similarly, on Al-Islam, there was another book that Hazur wrote, Hazrat Mirza Masroor Ahmad, may Allah be his helper, on the caricatures and the issue of blasphemy and all these things. So those books are also available on alislam.org. Then we have on Al-Islam again, there are articles that talk about the true love that was shown for the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam by the promised Messiah alayhi salam and by others. So, that's the true way, right? Allah says in the Holy Quran that the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is uswatun hasanatun, that he had the most exemplary model, and that's the model that we should be following, that we should try to follow and improve our relationship with him, our love for him. Allah says that if you claim to love Allah, then follow the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So following his practices, following his magnanimity, and even in his own lifetime there were examples of blasphemy. He did not react angrily, he did not punish them, or he did not go after those people. He showed love, he showed compassion. We have this issue of blasphemy that sometimes is linked with this topic. We have, for instance, one book by Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmad Rahimahullah Ta'ala, and let me show you that in the end of my initial comments here. It's called Islam's Response to Contemporary Issues. Okay, this book has a chapter on the issue of blasphemy, and you can find it in the contents. Let me try to find it faster by just doing a search here. Yes, blasphemy, page 38. And Hazur gives the example that Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmad Rahimahullah Ta'ala gives the example of Abdullah bin Ubay, who had committed extreme heinous blasphemy, and how he was treated with such kindness by the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's worth a read, this chapter on blasphemy in this book. So these are a few comments I wanted to make in the beginning of my Ask an Imam today. And if you have any questions, like I mentioned in the beginning, you can submit your questions through the live chat on YouTube or through the comment section on Facebook or through the main live stream on Twitter. So I have several of you saying salam, alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. And one person from Facebook is saying Ramadan Kareem to you as well, Ramadan Mubarak to you as well. May Allah bless you richly as well. Thank you for joining this program and for being part of this program. Rizwan has asked that how does one reply to allegations surrounding Hazrat Aisha's age. Hazrat Aisha radiallahu anha. There are questions that are asked about her age. There are resources on alislam.org, which you can use to learn more about her age. And let me take you to that website first and show you what kind of resources we have. And then I'll give you a short response to this issue as well. So I typed in Aisha age, and we have this: did Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam marry Aisha when she was only 6 years old? What is the proper age of marriage? So we have this short article that should cover most of the points that are in your mind that you want to convey to those people who make these allegations. One thing to keep in mind, in fact, I think this should be enough, but if you are looking for a very detailed, okay, so there's a Faith Matters program also that discusses this. It's a Muslim Sunrise article that discusses this. And then it doesn't show up in the search results, but you know, the book Life and Character of the Seal of Prophets, it has a detailed discussion on this topic as well. I'm not going to download the PDF at this moment, but you can find it if you like. This article should be enough. One thing to remember, you know, when it comes to this topic, is that when you're talking about the age of Hazrat Aisha radiallahu anha, you have to know your audience. What perspective is the audience coming from? So let's suppose, for instance, a few years ago, there was a mosque tour with some Christian friends, and one of them raised this question. So I responded to them from a Christian perspective. So we have the example of Hazrat Maryam, that is Mary, the mother of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. She apparently was married to Joseph at the age of 12. And Joseph at that time was 90 years old. And so this is a very crystal clear example of, you know, someone who is very much revered in the Christian world, who is marrying at the age of 12. And if we go by the records that are contained in the New Testament, she was already pregnant when she married him. So that pregnancy began probably when she was 11 years old. And of course, she was a virgin, and that itself is okay. But the marriage itself, nobody questions it. Nobody questions why a 12-year-old got married to Joseph. The reason why that is because marriage was, number one, always done at a very young age. In those times, marriage was a norm to be done very early. Even if you go back 100, 150 years, it was the norm for people getting married, boys and girls, at the age of 12 or 13 or 14. And even today, in some parts of the world, the marriageable age is set to be 14, right? When you say that 18 is the marriage, the age when you become an adult, it is otherwise an arbitrary number. I mean, not everyone is mature enough at 18. And not everyone is immature under the age of 18. Somebody could be 16 years of age and could be a lot more mature than someone who's 19 or 20, right? What we're looking for is maturity. And it's fine to have a law, and that law should be respected. And Hazrat Muslimah, the second caliph of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, has talked about this. He said that if you set an age for marriage, that is fine. If scientific evidence is there that the most reasonable age is 18, that's fine. There's nothing wrong with that. So setting the age is fine, and that should be respected. That should be the law. But what I'm speaking about is the norm in the past. If we want to raise allegations about the age of Hazrat Aisha radiallahu anha, then we would have to raise allegations about all the marriages that took place in those days, which includes our own ancestors, so our own great-great-grandmothers and great-great-great-grandmothers were getting married probably at the age of 11 or 12 or 14. Would that become objectionable? You know, maybe in our environment today, where we are more comfortable with a higher age, that's different. Because modern life is different. Modern life, there are some people who argue that the maturity has been delayed in modern life. For could be a number of factors. And there are some who say that education has become more systematized, right? It's more systematic, which means that by the age of 18, you have not even entered university, right? So it should be a little later. And that's fine. But what I'm saying is that if you want to raise allegations about, if anybody wants to raise allegations about Hazrat Aisha radiallahu anha, then we would have to make allegations about every person, every girl who got married at that age. And is that all objectionable throughout the history of humanity? And Mary, for instance, the example that I was talking about, is not an isolated incident or an isolated example. That means it was the norm at that time. And that norm has been going on for millennia. And the other point to remember is that, and this is something that the Promised Messiah alayhi salam has talked about when he responded to this allegation, is that, you know, even in the modern life, we have examples of girls at a very young age who become pregnant, right? And there are some statistics, even in Canada, and you can find them online very easily, of girls at a very young age becoming pregnant, as low as 8 or 9 years. And this is not something I'm making up or just to defend or because I'm biased. This is something that is a reality, and you can search for this on Google or do your research on this topic. Even in the modern life, there are examples, there are exceptions, there are cases of that. I'm not saying that this is right. This is not right. This is not something that I am supporting, or this is not something that Islam supports. This is something that is the reality of our times, and there should be some laws to mitigate that, to prevent that, and some societal moral ways in which we should combat this behavior. The final point I wanted to make is, and this is something also, again, I read in one of the writings of Hazrat Muslim radiallahu anhu in this regard, is that we also know that Hazrat Aisha reached the age of maturity a lot earlier than others who were her contemporaries. And we also know that some of the narrations about her own, about her actual age of marriage, you know, are false. Like some narration that says that she was 9, that is not correct. And there are reasons for that, and you can read that in the article that I just shared with you. And if you want more detail, then you can go to the book Life and Character of the Seal of Prophets, where our scholars have determined, where Hazrat Mirza Bashir Ahmad Sahib radiallahu anhu has determined that her age was actually 12 when the marriage was consummated. There was nikah earlier, but the actual consummation of marriage was at the age of 12. So I've already spoken a lot about this. I don't want to have the whole Ask an Imam today on this one topic. But you know, these are some resources that you can use and learn more on this topic. All right, let's move on. Many of you have said salam. Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah, and thank you for joining this program. Can you explain why men are prohibited to wear gold? And is that only for gold, and men can wear silver or diamond rings? I'm not too sure about diamond rings. I do know that silver is okay, because we have men who wear silver rings, and especially in the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, we wear rings which say, "Alaysa Allahu bi kafin abdahu," is Allah not sufficient for his servant? And which is a verse of the Holy Quran. And why is gold prohibited? I don't have the hadith which talks about this in front of me, so I haven't checked what kind of reasoning that is given there, but my understanding is that gold, wearing of gold, is something that is common among women. And because women are doing something commonly, men are discouraged from imitating women. just as women are discouraged from imitating men. And there has to be a gender distinction between men and women, and that's why certain prohibitions are there for men and certain prohibitions are there for women in terms of their dress as well, right? There's a greater modesty required from women when they're in the public. And then there is for men, for instance, they're encouraged to keep a beard that makes them distinctively, men or masculine. And so the idea is that if they wear gold, they would be imitating women and they would start to become like women. And they would also start possibly trying to live a lavish lifestyle. It's about a lifestyle that would be developed out of what we wear. You know, whatever we wear, it has an impact. I'm wearing a cap, for instance. It has an impact on how I feel. When we go for prayers, why do we cover our heads? One reason is that the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to cover his head, but also it brings a certain calmness and a certain, attention, formality to what you are doing. And, the similar application is there for what we wear, the clothes we wear, the colors that we wear. And yes, we are allowed to wear, for instance, t-shirts, but if the t-shirt says something vulgar on top of it, a Muslim shouldn't be wearing that because it has an impact on himself and on the people around him. So similarly, if we are told not to wear gold and to leave those ornaments for women, it means that the idea is that we should not become like women, and women should have their own distinction in this regard. I hope that made sense to you. All right. Some people have said Ramzan Mubarak to all of you as well. We are at the sixth day of fasting, and it is it already is starting to feel like it is going by very fast. And let us employ this month to pray to Allah, to ask Him for whatever we need, and to get closer to Allah Almighty as well. One person has asked that, how can I build taqwa and the love of Allah? I find myself doing right or not doing wrong things just because I know it is right or wrong, not necessarily because of Allah. How can I change that? So even if you are doing things that are right and not doing certain things that are wrong, that is still because of Allah, because Allah is the one who is the true source of morality, right? Remember this thing, that whenever we do something right or something wrong, it is actually coming to us from Allah. Allah is the one who knows what is right and what is wrong, and He tells us what is right and what is wrong. And as far as building taqwa and love of Allah is concerned, it depends on our intentions before our actions. There's a hadith of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam which says, innamal a'malu bin niyyat. All actions are judged by intentions. There's one incident long time ago, I read it, I don't have the reference in front of me right now, but that said that one companion of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had built a house or bought a house or something, and he invited the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to come and have a look and to pray. And the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came, and on one side there was a window, and the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked him, Why do you have this window here? And he said, I had this window because I want fresh air and ventilation and so on and so forth. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that if you had said that window will be a means for me to hear the azan more easily, that would have been better for you. Because then your intention would be that this is for azan and you will be getting blessings for it. But you will also be getting the benefit, the other benefit, the secondary benefit of the airflow and the ventilation that would also be there. That will not change, but you will also be getting blessings because that was your intention. So that's why in Islam, we are taught to stay God conscious. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Whenever we start something, we should say in the name of Allah, the gracious and merciful. So remaining God conscious, always thinking of Allah, this is something, a mindset that has to be developed over time, that you know, you're always thinking of Allah and whenever you are doing this. And finding good company, staying in the company of people who have taqwa, who have love for Allah. And true love for Allah, as I was talking about in the beginning of this program as well, is by following the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So how would he do those things, right? How much zikr did he do in his day-to-day affairs? How much did he remember Allah, right? A lot, right? So we should be offering our prayers in that way. We should be offering nawafil. Allah says that if you want to get closer to Allah, you should be offering lots and lots of nawafil prayer. So we offer nafil prayer. We offer voluntary prayers. We try to follow the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. These are a few steps you can take if you want to improve in taqwa and love of Allah. Okay. Question is that if one were to look at the state of the world today, then they would find that it is in a much worse state than what it was a century ago. How is it that this worsening of the world doesn't disprove the claim of Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad alayhi salam? You know, Allah has, I got a similar question in another recent live stream. Allah has, you know, with the coming of prophets, Allah shows us that there's a right way and there's a wrong way. If you accept the prophet of Allah, that is the right way. If you reject the prophet of Allah, that is the wrong way. So the coming of the promised Messiah alayhi salam doesn't mean that our free will is gone. We still have free will, and this is something that is mentioned in the Holy Quran as well. And let me show that to you quickly. That if you go to alislam.org and scroll down to the, you know, the Quran app, the readquran.app, you type in chapter 91, verse 9. Okay. In this verse, Allah says, فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا. Right? He revealed to it in the ways of evil and in the ways of righteousness. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا. He indeed truly prospers he who purifies it. I think there's something wrong with the font here. So let me change the font. Okay, hopefully that would... Okay, there we go. So we have this these verses of the Holy Quran that Allah says that he revealed to it the ways of evil and the ways of righteousness. He indeed truly prospers who purifies it. So Allah is clearly saying that the way of evil and the way of righteousness is clear to all of us. It is up to us to choose which path we wish to go on. And the coming of the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, does not mean that people will lose their free will and no one would have the free will to do something wrong. People want to do something wrong, then they have the free will, just as they had the free will at the times of previous prophets. And even at the time of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, right after he passed away, there was a whole huge group of former Muslims who became apostates at the time of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And of course, later on, that came to an end as well. But that does not mean that the message of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has become tainted because a number of people who were actually in the tens of thousands who had become apostates. And similarly, even during the life of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there was the Battle of Hunain, where there was a chaos because of all these new Muslims who started retreating. So in the time of Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad Alayhi Salam, if people, some people are, you know, going to the wrong side, then that doesn't impact anything. In the long run, Allah has said that there has to be evolution, there's a process. And through that process, eventually, there will come a time. And the Promised Messiah Alayhi Salam has made prophecies as through from Allah. There are prophecies that eventually the Ahmadiyya Muslim community will prevail over all others. So, you know, these things are bound to happen. They were predicted to happen. They were prophesied to happen. In fact, there were even prophecies that during the time of the Promised Messiah, the ulama, the so-called scholars among the Muslims will turn against him. So that also happened. And there's a process. And with the grace of Allah, eventually a time will come when these things will all be reversed. Okay. I will take one more question before the end of the stream today. Why do we believe that hell is temporary? There's a simple answer to this, and let me, and this will be the last question that I'm taking up today. I know I got a lot of other questions, and for one question, it took me some time to answer because it required a detailed answer. Okay, so this would be the last question I am going to take up today. So why do you believe hell is temporary? It is based on the Holy Quran. I'm not sure if you are an Ahmadi Muslim or a non-Ahmadi Muslim or from what perspective you're asking, but the Quran is very clear on this. There's a verse of the Holy Quran that I want to show you that mentions this. So if you go to the Quran and in Arabic, if you search Rahmati, okay. Allah says, "Wa rahmati wasiat kulla shayin." It did not show up here. Okay, let's try my mercy. Let's see if that brings the verse. No, it has brought us too many. The reason why I try to show you this search is that as I answer the question, you're also able to benefit from the different, you know, the trial and error I'm doing here. It helps us learn the Quran better. It helps us, you know, benefit from the Quran better. So it did not show up here in my effort. It will take longer. And as I'm coming to the end of the stream, I don't have the time. But basically, Allah says that His mercy encompasses all things. It is not possible for Allah to punish someone for eternity. It is not possible because eventually the mercy of Allah will overtake this. Also in the Holy Quran, if you read chapter 9, verses 109 and 110, when it comes to heaven, Allah is clear in saying that this is a reward that shall never be cut off. But regarding hell, Allah says that He will do whatever He pleases. So that means that there will come a time. And the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has also said that a time will come in hell where it will become empty. And people will be taken out of it. So based on the Quran, based on the principle that Allah's fundamental attribute, you know, the fundamental attributes of Allah are that He is merciful. We have the four fundamental attributes of Allah in the Surah Fatiha, Rabb, Rahman, Rahim, and Malik. So Allah is Rahman, Allah is gracious, Allah is Rahim, Allah is merciful. And Allah is Malik. He controls everything. So He will eventually forgive after they have suffered for a period of time, after they have been purged of the corruption in their soul and the evil that was within their souls, they will be brought into heaven. And this is based on the, as I mentioned, in the Quran and the Ahadith. Jazakallah, that's all the time I had for today. I really appreciate all of you who joined this program. Please remember me and the alislam.org team in your prayers in this month of Ramadan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammadin wa barik wa sallim.